If deep time is incomprehensible, how does the human brain actually understand the deep time over which it is now believed to have evolved? So this is like a tricky question, right? You gotta read this a couple times before you understand what it means. But basically, Darwin asks us to imagine that human beings, along with other animals and plants, emerged over deep time, that over millions and millions of years, human beings changed from essentially apes and monkeys into the people that we have today. The human brain is therefore not just a product of evolution, but it is a product of deep time. How does the brain understand the deep time over which it is believed to have evolved? So this also requires conceptualization. People had been thinking about the brain for several hundred years. This is an example of how you can look at different kinds of brains over the course of the 18th century. So comparing brains, thinking about brains, this idea is not new. But what you have in the 19th century is the first effort to understand the human brain in geological terms as the product of deep time. So they imagine that there's a lower part of the brain that is very, very primitive, and it can only understand space in terms of time. That is, it takes me 3 days to walk to Menlo Park. That is how far Menlo Park is from here. It takes me 3 days to walk there. That's the primitive part of the brain, they think, in the 19th century. Over time, the higher parts of the brain, like geological strata accreting, begin to get deposited in the human mind, leading to our modern advanced brains. How do we know they're modern and advanced? Is that we can imagine time in terms of space. We have things like clocks that help us to see time in spatial terms, and this is a sign of how advanced we are. So the human brain begins to be imagined like a geological stratum in the 19th century, that its strata, like rocks, are layered through time. Now let me show you how that idea has crept into our way of thinking and talking today in ways that we didn't even know. Many of us, all of you in this room, have certainly used the term the stream of consciousness, and you have probably used it without understanding the origins of this term. Well, it emerges from the deep time revolution in the writing of the Harvard psychologist William James, who studied with the geologist Louis Agassiz at Harvard and was very, very influenced by this new deep time way of thinking, not just about the Earth as layered strata, but about the human brain as layered strata. So he tried to explain how you could understand the flow of human thought as a kind of geological process. So he asks you to imagine saying this sentence: the pack of cards is on the table. This is gonna bring back traumatic memories of diagramming sentences in seventh grade. So I'm sorry, because it brought those back for me. Sorry, Mrs. Colley, I didn't like diagramming sentences. But William James is asking us to imagine, and I brought a prop. So here, look at this. The pack of cards is on the table. And he's asking you to diagram what the brain is doing as it is thinking that thought. So, and he calls this the stream of consciousness. So here's what he's imagining. Remember the XY axis I showed you earlier in the talk? This is exactly what he's doing. He's imagining you saying this sentence: the pack of cards is on the table, and the 1, 2, 3, and 4 is not grammatical, right? It's just like time. Time is happening. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then he has this y-axis, this spatial dimension, and what the space is not a kind of geological stratum, but it is what he calls the fullness of thought. So as you're saying the sentence, and as you're thinking it, your mind is getting fuller and fuller and fuller of the thought of the pack of cards being on the table. So that at the end of the sentence, you're way up high with your thinking about the pack of cards being on the table. Now, what's interesting about this is that he says, if you put a knife through the center of the thought, imagine doing that, put a knife through the center of the thought, you would find it suffused with the whole of all of the rest of the thought, just like a knife cutting through the strata of the rocks that I have been showing you would show you cutting through all of the strata of the earth. So when you use the term the stream of consciousness, he means a stream in the literal geological sense of the term, that our brains have thoughts running through them that are like streams that erode through our minds, and that we can diagram them like a geological stratum.